Today's Western rulers have learned the lesson of the Weimar Republic perfectly and have, so to speak, cooled the hot spirits of the primordial participatory ardor of the times of universal suffrage. They therefore agreed that the democratic participatory ardor, They therefore agreed that the democratic system has, like all forms of government, a desperate need for a strong instinct for self-preservation. On the contrary, it has much more need than the totalitarian forms of government. Torn by an incurable absence of narration and metaphysics, aimed at legitimizing the current status quo from above, which is daily eroded by the same nihilism it has evoked, the liberal system continually tries to build a civil religion to occupy the altars from which God has been dethroned. The liberal civil religion, already cherished by Auguste Comte, is nothing but the dogmatism of human rights. True religion of the Ten Commandments of the 21st century. Highlighting the artificiality of those who first mock religions in themselves, but then try to create one, totally invented from scratch only one to cement his creaking ideas, is now the most necessary element for an authentic revolutionary practice. Therefore, among the main objective of true revolutionary of our century, there is the stripping of the human rights of their aura of sacredness, to reduce them, the human rights, to what they are, a Western ideological construction, like fascism and communism. Logically refutable and above all, without any superior dignity to other systems, political or spiritual, which these rights try to undermine. The liberal prophet John Locke given rise to liberalism, but it was the Declaration of Independence of the United States of America that codified the commandments of human rights, which today are the gospel of this new civil religion. This pseudo-gospel doesn't speak of God as a commonly understood by the monotheists or their pagan ancestors, but talks about a generic God of nature. This God of nature, qualifying nature as divine in itself, therefore obeys the enlightened dictate of the good man from his first day of life, ennobling his wildest instincts as they are good, since they are perfectly natural. This vision fits perfectly with liberalism, which sees the world not as a social harmonization between a myriad of antithetical positions, but as a continuous collision of forces that fight and submit to one another in the name of party interests. If, on the other hand, man is good by nature, it is obvious that he has rights because of the simple fact that he exists. If, therefore, human rights are the spiritual and metapolitical cornerstone of the liberal system, they must be politically and intellectually attacked. Here we are not in the presence of the natural law of which St. Thomas Aquinas had long spoken, but of a precise entity very different, the state of nature. This conception of the world, fiercely opposed by Hegel a few years later, made the fortune of the contractual conception of liberal society, which launched the American and British bourgeoisies into the domination and pillage of the world. In the letter on tolerance, Locke had initiated the liberal conception of the state by stating, "The state, in my view, is a human society constituted solely for the purpose of preserving and promoting civil goods. I call civic goods life, freedom, physical integrity, and the absence of pain, and also property of external objects such as land, money, and furniture." As the United States Declaration of Independence will testify almost a century later, Locke, civil goods will soon become civil rights, and later human rights. According to the British thinker, the man naturally tended to this law, and the state had to be nothing but an aid to this natural disposition which man would carry with him from the most primitive times, without ever attempting to assume an educational function and ethics towards its citizens, seen as good by nature. It is the natural goodness of John Locke, which is than the basis of the modern conception of human rights. If man is by nature good, clearly it will be right for him to have established rights from his birth. On the other hand, Hegel identified the dangerousness of Locke's thesis on time and affirmed the senselessness of conceiving rights as the foundation of a society yet to be built, while it was rather a society once built to be able to grant rights precisely as holder of sufficient power to grant them and the strength necessary to defend them and to punish those who violated them. Without a temporal and spiritual precedence of society over rights, this would have become nothing other than the absolutist dominion of the brutes, of the strongmen, who taking advantage of the lack of a power that regulated the state of nature. It would have easy for this system oppressing the weak, giving life to an anarchist and bold regime based solely on terror. This is actually what liberalism really wants, and it is the reason for its atavistic fascination with wild cultures and primitivism. It is this fascination that generates liberal love for immigration before any other economic interest. From our point of view, instead, human rights, as conceived by the founding father of the United States and by the Jacobins, are nothing more than an instrument of oppression of the individual on the community, a rebellion against the law, the first moment of the objective spirit. A rebellion and antithesis as negative as necessary in view of a synthesis in ethicality which would then lead to concern the interest of the individual with the common good. What foundation can be, then, those rights that are not first born from a use or a law? And from which rules will the legitimacy of a right come, so glorious as to grant a value greater than the law and the rights themselves? Man, therefore, that little creator who does not even have the power to create an insect, believes himself to be so powerful as to be able by himself to also create the ineffable power that constitutes the transcendent core of sovereignty, because laws since sealed by a transcendent higher principle. Human rights are therefore placed in the fatal and meta-historical struggle between the traditional principle of sovereignty and the liberal principle of contract. If therefore liberal contractualism assesses human rights as the only gospel that should legitimize it, the European spiritual revolution of the sovereignty opposes it with the material factor of blood, a true certifier of national and continental identities, as well as a door of the law through the just war and art. Art as a vehicle, the only one left in the de-ritualized age, able to reconnect us through the rediscovery of the harmony proportions of sound and perfection to that exiled God, today the only one who can save us, as stated by Heidegger. Only art will be the foundry and the factory of dreams that will throw again the young revolution, because the beautiful can only march with us. Reconnected to the amazement, eliminated the liberal wax from our ears, then we will finally enjoy the sight of a new starry and returned luminous sky, where the gods will still be able to revive the many crowns without heads now enclosed in the museum cases, and where they will bless again the bloodshed for the revolutionary of a new Europe. The political contradiction that links contemporary sovereignists to slavery with regard to the 68 rhetorics of the worst of which the remains of modern Western state floats can only be solved by the fundamental philosophical, political and historical passage that starts from the philosophical denial of liberal contractualism to pass and return to an idealistic conception and at the same time traditional and conservative, not only of politics but of society and of man in general. This is the true spiritual revolution necessary for the European continent. The emancipation of patriotism by the cultural yardstick of the aforementioned subversive antithesis necessarily and unavoidably passes from the bonfire of the fetish of the bon sauvage, which sees the savage, the primitive, as good because of his close to the condition of blessed by God of nature, cited by the United States constitutionalists. Clearly, this can be only expressed in the refusal of human rights, both as a juridical structure and as a typical democratic artificial fake law, good only as a foundation for a regime oppressed by the burdens of its own contradictions. To free ourselves from human rights, which in reality are nothing more than the rights of the single, is therefore necessary step towards sovereignty, since they constitute the chain that prevents the state from freeing itself from the selfish particularism of the desiring monads, unwanted yet unenabled doctor of liberalism and Jacobin states. The states, and consequently the people, cannot in fact be sovereign in the, if the individual is continually opposite to them. Human rights, which with their mystic of the search of happiness, open their doors to the worst pantagruel hysteria of unstrained consumption, are therefore the keystone under which to position the philosophical dynamite to bring the liberal capitalist society to collapse, and to affirm the sovereignty of peoples and nations and state once again. The awareness that the thesis and the antithesis will be followed by a synthesis will therefore have to greet the patriots of the present and of the future, showing him how this synthesis will be nothing but an ethical revolution, which will focus on the individual only when the well will correspond to the concept of collective good. Something very different from the welfare of liberals, which Locke defined only as possession of goods and absence of pain. Only a good practice of freedom, which is expressed in the recognition of finiteness of the individual human life, today's Western rulers have learned the lesson of the Weimar Republic perfectly and have, so to speak, cooled the hot spirits of the primordial participatory ardor of the times of universal suffrage. They therefore agreed that the democratic participatory ardor, They therefore agreed that the democratic system has, like all forms of government, a desperate need for a strong instinct for self-preservation. On the contrary, it has much more need than the totalitarian forms of government. Torn by an incurable absence of narration and metaphysics, aimed at legitimizing the current status quo from above, which is daily eroded by the same nihilism it has evoked, the liberal system continually tries to build a civil religion to occupy the altars from which God has been dethroned. The liberal civil religion, already cherished by Auguste Comte, is nothing but the dogmatism of human rights. True religion of the Ten Commandments of the 21st century. Highlighting the artificiality of those who first mock religions in themselves, but then try to create one, totally invented from scratch only one to cement his creaking ideas, is now the most necessary element for an authentic revolutionary practice. Therefore, among the main objective of true revolutionary of our century, there is the stripping of the human rights of their aura of sacredness, to reduce them, the human rights, to what they are, a Western ideological construction, like fascism and communism. Logically refutable and above all, without any superior dignity to other systems, political or spiritual, which these rights try to undermine. The liberal prophet John Locke given rise to liberalism, but it was the Declaration of Independence of the United States of America that codified the commandments of human rights, which today are the gospel of this new civil religion. This pseudo-gospel doesn't speak of God as a commonly understood by the monotheists or their pagan ancestors, but talks about a generic God of nature. This God of nature, qualifying nature as divine in itself, therefore obeys the enlightened dictate of the good man from his first day of life, ennobling his wildest instincts as they are good, since they are perfectly natural. This vision fits perfectly with liberalism, which sees the world not as a social harmonization between a myriad of antithetical positions, but as a continuous collision of forces that fight and submit to one another in the name of party interests. If, on the other hand, man is good by nature, it is obvious that he has rights because of the simple fact that he exists. If, therefore, human rights are the spiritual and metapolitical cornerstone of the liberal system, they must be politically and intellectually attacked. Here we are not in the presence of the natural law of which St. Thomas Aquinas had long spoken, but of a precise entity very different, the state of nature. This conception of the world, fiercely opposed by Hegel a few years later, made the fortune of the contractual conception of liberal society, which launched the American and British bourgeoisies into the domination and pillage of the world. In the letter on tolerance, Locke had initiated the liberal conception of the state by stating, "The state, in my view, is a human society constituted solely for the purpose of preserving and promoting civil goods. I call civic goods life, freedom, physical integrity, and the absence of pain, and also property of external objects such as land, money, and furniture." As the United States Declaration of Independence will testify almost a century later, Locke's civil goods will soon become civil rights, and later human rights. According to the British thinker, the man naturally tended to this law, and the state had to be nothing but an aid to this natural disposition which man would carry with him from the most primitive times, without ever attempting to assume an educational function and ethics towards its citizens, seen as good by nature. It is the natural goodness of John Locke, which is then the basis of the modern conception of human rights. If man is by nature good, clearly it will be right for him to have established rights from his birth. On the other hand, Hegel identified the dangerousness of Locke's thesis on time and affirmed the senselessness of conceiving rights as the foundation of a society yet to be built, while it was rather society once built to be able to grant rights precisely as holder of sufficient power to grant them and the strength necessary to defend them and to punish those who violated them. Without the temporal and spiritual precedence of society over rights, this would have become nothing other than the absolutist dominion of the brutes, of the strongmen, who taking advantage of the lack of a power that regulated the state of nature. It would have been easy for this system oppressing the weak, giving life to an anarchist and bold regime based solely on terror. This is actually what liberalism really wants. And it is the reason for its atavistic fascination with wild cultures and primitivism. It is this fascination that generates liberal love for immigration before any other economic interest. From our point of view, instead, human rights, as conceived by the founding father of the United States and by the Jacobins, are nothing more than an instrument of oppression of the individual on the community, a rebellion against the law, the first moment of the objective spirit. A rebellion and antithesis as negative as necessary in view of a synthesis in ethicality which would then lead to coincide the interest of the individual with the common good. What foundation can be, then, those rights that are not first born from a use or a law? And from which rules will the legitimacy of a right come, so glorious as to grant a value greater than the law and the rights themselves? Man, therefore, that little creator who does not even have the power to create an insect, believes himself to be so powerful as to be able by himself to also create the ineffable power that constitutes the transcendent core of sovereignty, because laws since sealed by a transcendent higher principle. Human rights are therefore placed in the fatal and meta-historical struggle between the traditional principle of sovereignty and the liberal principle of contract. If, therefore, liberal contractualism assesses human rights as the only gospel that should legitimize it, The European spiritual revolution of the sovereignty opposes it with the material factor of blood, a true certifier of national and continental identities, as well as a door of the law through the just war and art. Art as a vehicle, the only one left in the de-ritualized age, able to reconnect us through the rediscovery of the harmony proportions of sound and perfection to that exiled God, today the only one who can save us, as stated by Heidegger. Only art will be the foundry and the factory of dreams that will throw again the young revolution, because the beautiful can only march with us. Reconnected to the amazement, eliminated the liberal wax from our ears, then we will finally enjoy the sight of a new starry and returned luminous sky, where the gods will still be able to revive the many crowns without heads now enclosed in the museum cases, and where they will bless again the bloodshed for the revolutionary of a new Europe. The political contradiction that links contemporary sovereignists to slavery with regard to the 68 rhetorics of the worst of which the remains of modern Western state floats can only be solved by the fundamental philosophical, political, and historical passage that starts from the philosophical denial of liberal contractualism to pass and return to an idealistic conception and, at the same time, traditional and conservative, not only of politics, but of society and of man in general. This is the true spiritual revolution necessary for the European continent. The emancipation of patriotism by the cultural yardstick of the aforementioned subversive antithesis necessarily and unavoidably passes from the bonfire of the fetish of the bon sauvage, which sees the savage, the primitive, as good because of his close to the condition of blessed by God of nature, cited by the United States constitutionalist. Clearly, this can be only expressed in the refusal of human rights, both as a juridical structure and as a typical democratic artificial fake law, good only as a foundation for a regime oppressed by the burdens of its own contradictions. To free ourselves from human rights, which in reality are nothing more than the rights of the single, is therefore necessary step towards sovereignty, since they constitute the chain that prevents the state from freeing itself from the selfish particularism of the desiring monads, unwanted yet undeniable doctor of liberalism and Jacobin states. The states, and consequently the people, cannot in fact be sovereign if the individual is continually opposite to them. Human rights, which with their mystic of the search of happiness, open their doors to the worst pantagruel hysteria of unstrained consumption, are therefore the keystone under which to position the philosophical dynamite to bring the liberal capitalist society to collapse and to affirm the sovereignty of peoples and nations and state once again. The awareness that the thesis and the antithesis will be followed by a synthesis will therefore have to be the patriots of the present and of the future, showing him how this synthesis will be nothing but an ethical revolution which will focus on the individual only, when the well will correspond to the concept of collective good. Something very different from the welfare of liberals, which Locke defined only as possession of goods and absence of pain. Only a good practice of freedom, which is expressed in the recognition of finiteness of the individual human life, in a neither religious sense, automatically evokes the divine blessing only and exclusively through this, the holy oil returns to anoint the hands of the kings and of the emperors of Europe. The chain is close to breaking, and the awareness of the inevitability of synthesis, which so agitates our detractors, must guide the legislator of tomorrow, who will be called to give shape to a new Europe, in the tabula rasa of the which will be needed to dig new furrows and lay new foundations. Europe is watching us, and may the heaven grant us sufficient strength to sacrifice our own idols on the altar of victory. Thank you all.